Assistant Vice President for Government Relations and an adjunct instructor in St. John's College, Department of Government Politics. It's my privilege to welcome you here tonight, and I will serve as the moderator for tonight's discussion. Tonight's forum marks the fifth consecutive year that the university has sponsored Meet the Candidate Nights on campus under our Participate initiative. This year, in addition to the support of the St. John's University College Democrats and College Republicans, we are pleased to again have cable channel New York One serving as a media partner and co-sponsor of tonight's event. The Participate initiative is a civic engagement program that seeks to inform and engage the university community and the political process and to encourage active citizenship in the community. I do want to announce that in accordance with Internal Revenue Code and university policy, St. John's University is prohibited from participating or intervening in any political campaign on behalf of or in opposition to any candidate for elected office. St. John's University does not endorse any particular political party affiliation, but encourages all citizens to be engaged and involved in the political process. We have a very ambitious evening planned for tonight, with several candidates scheduled to visit us, some already here. But before I begin, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge some, introduce others, and to go over the format for tonight's program. I want to personally thank in advance all of the candidates running for office who are with us here tonight, who will be joining us. All of them took time out of their busy schedule to be with us, and for that, the university is grateful. Thank you. I also want to thank my colleagues who worked hard on tonight's program, including Liz Riley from the Office of Media Relations and Dominic Sienna, Assistant Vice President of Media Relations. Our program is going to work like this. To open, candidates will each be given 2 minutes of uninterrupted time to present their stump speech. After all of the candidates have introduced themselves, our panelists will then pose questions to the candidates. The panelists will determine amongst themselves how they wish to question the candidate, and when and if there is any need for a follow-up question. The panelists will determine whether they wish to pose the question to an individual candidate and/or to the entire dais. The panelists will decide what topics they wish to explore and for how long. Ms. Erin Kennedy. Erin Kennedy hails from the state of Maryland and is a senior honors program student at St. John's, double majoring in government politics and English with a minor in economics. She's highly involved in campus as the president of Pi Sigma Alpha, the Political Science Honor Society, president of the College Democrats. She has served as Education Vice President of Gamma Phi Beta and as a Campus Ministry Student Assistant for the Midnight Run program. Erin aspires to one day be an attorney and then an elected official. She is passionate about politics and serving those around her. Greg Mitchell. Greg Mitchell is a junior from Merrick, New York. Greg is a Government and Politics major in St. John's College of Liberal Arts and Sciences. He is also pursuing a minor in Business Studies. Being involved on campus is an important part of Greg's academic experience. Greg is currently the president of the College Republicans, where he has worked to build membership and outreach of that student organization. And now with 2 minutes of self-introductions and their best stump speech, we're going to start, or go actually right down the line. How about that? We'll start with Senator Tony DeVoe.
I hate the word stump speech. First of all, I want to thank St. John's University for holding this forum once again, and our panelists for taking time out of the busy schedule to sort of pose these questions. When I ran for public office for the first time in the city council, I ran on a reform platform, being in touch with the community. And I think my 8 years in the city council and now at the end of my first term in the state senate, I have done exactly that. And I'd like to continue to do that in all. If anything, you know, we made a dent in how Albany operates, a very small dent in the last couple of years, but we need to make a bigger dent. If any place calls out for reform in state government, it is Albany. And I think I have that record of reform, of experience, and community involvement that is what Albany needs right now. Thank you.
I've been privileged to serve in the state senate for the past 12 years, as the first woman, incidentally, from Queens County elected to the New York State Senate. 3 years ago, I chaired the Committee on Higher Education, and there are a number of areas that I've been involved with, but We've accomplished a great deal in Albany, I think, in the last couple of years. We've had an on-time budget for the past 2 years in a row. We provided the largest middle-class tax break in the past 50 years. There are many issues that still have to be dealt with, and certainly ethics reform and the climate and culture in Albany has to change. It absolutely has to change. I served, for example, on a committee that voted to expel a member of the legislature, a member of the Senate, who we felt had violated various ethics and personal relationships. But there's a lot more to be done. For example, we have to raise the minimum wage. We have to deal with hydrofracking, an issue that Senator Avella has been involved with. We have to do something about the DREAM Act, because immigrants are a major part, particularly the district in which I'm running. And I think we have to take these issues into consideration. But to me, the overarching issue, the most important issue facing the people in the 16th Senate District, is the same issue that's facing everybody throughout the state, and that's the economy and the lack of jobs. People want to work. The fact that unemployment's gone down a little bit is good. However, a lot more has to be done. And I think these issues combine to make this a very exciting time in Albany. And I am looking forward to continuing to serve. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Joseph Gutman. I'm going to be using my microphone. All right, because I think I'm projecting it up, and hopefully that each and every one of you here can hear me. I am a career civil servant, retired captain from NYPD. I've been serving a public-private program with the Federal Bureau of Investigation for the past 10 years. That program has focused on national critical infrastructure protection, and I was the chief executive officer of that program, running it as a non-for-profit business with no government funding. My platform basically is a smaller and more effective government. You've heard some things here coming from our two senators, and I'd say some of them are right on point. I don't agree with everything, but I think Albany does need a sea change. We need jobs in New York State. We need a business environment that is receptive to creating jobs in New York State. Our education system needs to be reformed. Our children need education as a gateway to their future. That's what I'm all about. A fresh new voice from Albany, a citizen legislator, somebody who hasn't been in government for 25, 30 years, somebody who really knows how to cross the aisle and talk to everybody, not just to somebody or somebody who contributes to my campaign. So that's what I'm all about, straight from the ranks of each of you, a father, three children, community resident in the Belrose area, from St. Gregory's Parish, part of the CYO programs. I've been involved in just about every aspect of life in the borough of Queens, and I look forward to being the next state senator for the 11th Senatorial District in Eastern Queens County. Thank you for the opportunity tonight.
Hi, everybody. And I really want to thank St. John for conducting this Meet the Candidate tonight. I came to New York in 1971 from Washington, D.C. I came to attend religious school. And after I graduated high school, I went on to seminary and for 3 years and then college. At that time, college wasn't for me because after the seminary, I really wanted to get out there and be part of the working world. And it was part of when I studied in college American government, I really couldn't make heads or tails out of it. And later on, I really learned to appreciate about that. In any case, I took bookkeeping. I went into private industry, and for a few years doing that, and then I ended up in the post office for 25 years. I'm a retired postal worker, and during that time, since '89, I invested in real estate. I renovated 6 properties, and I take a lot of pride in that. My big plank, yes, whenever I see my name in, listed somewhere, is about education. And it's partly because I appreciated religious education. As I said, I didn't always appreciate secular. And that's why I'm a big proponent of education, because I came to appreciate its value. I think that education is absolutely essential. It's transformative. If we had a superior educated workforce with advanced technical skills, our economy would be altogether in a different place. The way our educational system is set up, it also involves a tax structure, because middle class people are paying for other middle class public education, and they're also paying for the rich when rich people pay for, send their kids to public school. And there's also a lot of waste in education, which I think we could get rid of if we went to vouchers.
Okay.
I would also like to thank St. John's University. And I'll start as soon as my son stops playing the iPad. Sorry.
He's tweeting the event.
First of all, thank you all for coming. As a Korean American, I'm still not sure whether I should be proud or embarrassed of Gangnam style, but it's out there, and I suppose I should choose the proud side. Proud of it. My message is geared more towards the students and the young people, so please bear with me. On Saturday, my political opponent, Senator Stavisky, and I both attended the Korean parade in Manhattan. And we stood very close to each other around a gigantic pot of rice and vegetables called bibimbap, holding these fun wooden sticks and stirring the pot together in a sign of unity. And in some ways, it's just a silly symbolic gesture. But I'm kind of sentimental. I actually appreciated that very much. And we're here in the law building, and it brings back nightmares for me as an attorney. But as a litigation lawyer, I have my client, and my opposing counsel has their client, and so we basically duke it out, and kind of it gets not so pleasant sometimes. But the way I view this race and politics is, my client is the community, and Senator Stavisky's client is also the community. So, and we're all in it to try to serve the same client as best as we can. So I just don't have it in me, at least this cycle certainly, to view this as an adversarial process. So what I would like to say to the students is, to dare to stand your ground, and not when you get out there in the world, don't feel like you have to conform to the way that particular business is run or that particular organization is run. If everybody did that, where would Steve Jobs be? Where would all of these amazing gadgets in our pockets be? And I would just say, America really desperately needs leaders. Leaders like you sitting here. And again, I would challenge you to be those leaders. Thank you.
Now I'm going to turn it over to the panel.
Good evening. On behalf of the question panel, I'd like to welcome you and thank you all for being here. We're going to start with education and higher education issues in New York State. Please briefly explain what can or should be done to make both public and private higher education more affordable and accessible. This question is for the entire panel, and we're going to start with Senator Avella.
Well, first of all, let's talk about elementary education, the New York City public school system. I'm not a fan of the mayor and what he's done with the educational system in this city. I'm not totally opposed to mayoral control, but it shouldn't be just one person dictating how the educational system goes. Right now, we're teaching to the test, we're closing schools, we're not educating kids. And I'd like to see some reform done at the state level.
on how we tweak the mayoral system. I really think in the 10 years that the mayor has had control, we really have not had any real improvement. The federal tests that go on in the city schools show that there has really been no improvement. In terms of higher education, I have said for a long time, I think college education in the city of New York, CUNY, should be tuition free. Should be tuition free. It would cost about $800 million a year to do that. And one of the things that I've said for a long, long time is to legalize gambling in this state, and the Senate and the Assembly and the governor have now passed that. We actually have to pass it in the next legislature as well. But we could use some of that money to pay for free tuition in New York City, at least. Then we should also have the same thing for SUNY. Students need a college education. Years ago, high school graduation, high school certificate, enough. It is not enough anymore. And the cost to going to college simply increase each and every year. And it is just simply unacceptable. And the cost, like I said, for free tuition in CUNY is $800 million. That's a big nut to crack. But we have to do it. Education has to be at the forefront of anything we do in Albany.
Senator Stavisky.
I believe that education should be a seamless transition between pre-K and college or postgraduate. I voted against the original mayoral control. I voted for it for the renewal a couple of years ago. And I'm not sure that I would vote again to continue mayoral control because I've seen too many abuses. I think that closing a school and putting four schools in its place, such as the mayor proposed originally for Flushing High School, is a mistake. But it's higher education where I particularly have been involved. For one thing, I am troubled at the fact that students graduate from college in debt for years. That to me is very troubling. Now the tuition at St. John's is relatively low, so it's a little, you're smiling, but it's less of a problem than you go into Manhattan and Columbia charges $40,000 or $50,000 a year for just tuition alone. I am a proponent of CUNY and SUNY where tuition is affordable. We this year passed what is called the rational tuition policy, where tuition goes up gradually, grows up gradually, but it's predictable. So when you enter, you know what your tuition is going to be for the 4 years of CUNY and SUNY. Secondly, I am troubled by the fact that students entering college are often unprepared, and to me, it's not the job of St. John's or Queens College or Queensborough to provide remedial education for students. That should be done in the high schools and in the elementary schools. As far as St. John's goes, it's interesting. When I became chair of the Higher Ed Committee and I met with the head of the Commission on Independent Colleges and Universities, Laura Anglin, who is extremely knowledgeable. She's a former budget director for the state. And I was trying to figure out what's going to be her major pitch. Is she going to ask for an increase in Bundy aid, which is the aid to the non-public colleges? No. Her mission was the same as the public colleges, and that is increase TAP, the tuition assistance program. I think that's the solution. That too is a very expensive proposition, but. Combined with the increase in the debt that students have when they graduate, and sometimes it takes years and years to pay it off, and the fact that so many students are unprepared, I think this is a very troubling aspect. And I asked both the Chancellor of CUNY and the Chancellor of SUNY about that, and they did appoint a commission to check, to investigate the lack of preparedness on the part of the students.
We've been joined by Nily Rozic. I'm just going to give you a pass for a moment while you get settled, and then we'll go right to Mr. Concannon, and then when they're all finished up, I'll give you a minute to introduce yourself, and then we'll continue along.
Thanks very much. I appreciate that. And I hope you can hear me out there. If you can't, let me know. I'll try to raise it up a pitch. I'm afraid if I play with this microphone, we're all going to lose a little bit. All right. I think, as I said earlier, education is the gateway to freedom, right? For the American dream for many of our kids. I've had three kids. One of them now is through college. One of them is at her fourth year, the end of her fourth year of college over at East Stroudsburg University in Pennsylvania. And I have a son who is kind of intimidated about the whole college experience and decided to go into the Marine Corps as a reservist so that he could have the government pay some portion of his college as he goes on. You know, it's easy for me to stand up here and say that I think every student at St. John should have a Maserati or something similar to that. It would be very simple. But at the end of the day, somebody is going to have to get paid. Somebody gets paid to turn the lights on in this building. Somebody gets paid for the audio. We'll have to check into that. All right? And every other function in this building, they get paid for. So I think it is disingenuous of me to offer to you a free college education. I don't know that we have that ability to do that without bankrupting our states or without further burdening either our businesses or our homes. Anyone can get up in front of the public and promise them an endless list of things that they would like to see for free. I would like to see free health care. I would like to see, as I think Mayor Bloomberg recently said, free transportation for everyone. These are grand ideas, impossible to fund, all right? The burden on families already is tough enough. Making a go of it is not easy. The price of gasoline in California peaked over $5 a gallon. Do you know what that does to the consumable goods that you and I and every other person in this room consume every single day? That's what it's all about. So you can't just give away education for free, just like you can't give away a lot of other things. But you can certainly do other things to incentivize students to join within the higher education area. I want to get back to New York City and the New York City Department of Education, Board of Education. I think it's very important that we focus on one thing, and that's focusing in on the classroom. And what is the chief resource in every classroom? That's the teacher. Too long and too far and too wide are we concentrating on things other than reading, writing, and arithmetic. We're not good at doing the education thing in New York City. We can vastly improve upon it, and until we get those resources fixed at the teacher and at the students in the classroom, the reading, writing, and arithmetic, then we can go into all these other grandiose programs that might be very nice to have, and it might work for one student or another student, but we've got to make sure that we've got the basics down first. If we have the basics down, I'm all for expanding a successful program if we can do something like that. And I'm also for encouraging students to get involved in a whole host of after-school programs as well. It's just we have limits within our budgets that we can work a lot of these programs with. And I think we've really got to hone in on what we should be doing best for the children here in New York City. As I mentioned, I've got three kids that have all come through various levels. Myself, I'm a graduate of public high school education. And I have a grandson who's going to be coming through that educational system fairly soon as well. So I am very concerned about what goes on. And I'm concerned about the opportunity that awaits him when he finally makes it to college, nevertheless preschool and everything else. All right? So that's kind of where I stand on the issue.
All right. So I take it we're addressing both K through high school and higher education? Just higher education. Okay. well, it turns out that people follow trends, and we've had different bubbles, the internet bubble, housing bubble, and some people are saying that there's a college bubble. The idea that everybody has to go to college and get a liberal arts degree, I mean, if there's a specialized degree, that's something else. But But a liberal arts degree, I attended a lecture where the person was talking about how these degrees are really diluted, and as it turns out, Ms. Stavisky referred to it, that there's $1 trillion in student debt that students are having trouble paying. And 50% of college students this year were not able to find work. So it's now, I also spoke to somebody in education. He said that the public schools fell apart, or there was a great decline once the emphasis was turned away from or vocational training was greatly diminished. So this follows a trend, or the trend continues into higher education, where people are not concentrating on real marketable technical skills, and they're running towards this generalized college liberal arts degree, and it's turning out that the market is rejecting it by not rewarding these graduates with work, and it's costing these students a ton of money. And now the idea is President Obama and others are saying, well, let's forgive the debt. Well, yeah, I mean, people are caught in a real situation. Perhaps the debt should be forgiven, but this is not something we should continue. That's not a rewarding path for us to go on.
Mr. Kim.
My wife hates it when I say this, but I can honestly say that I enjoyed the time when I was a dishwasher more than being a lawyer. But the reason I say this is because, you know, in our culture, you know, it's either high school or, you know, high level college, you know, higher education, which is, you know, very very expensive, and, you know, there's just a lot of, what do you call it, infrastructure and investment in it. You know, I think, you know, not to, to knock it one bit, but I think we need to encourage another layer, like technical schools, and going back to my silly example of washing dishes, there are all kinds of activities in our society, and I think we've, you know, labeled the different activities too specifically. So, you know, and that's actually, you know, driving up the cost of education, hurting society. So I think we need that another layer where we can, you know, encourage all kinds of, like, whether it's, you know, all kinds of activities like driving trucks, you know, washing dishes, like business, like, you know, lower level business activity. Nobody really has the answer to this question, you know, but that's my little 2 cents worth for that. Thank you.
Okay, we were joined in progress by Ms. Rozic. I'm going to give you 1 minute to introduce yourself, and we'll pick up the program from there.
Sure. Well, thank you for having me. I'm sorry that I'm late. I only live 2 blocks away, so luckily I got here just in time. Many of you know my story. I am a first-generation American. I moved to Fresh Meadows when I was only 2 years old. And since then, I went to local schools in the area, including Townsend Harris High School, one of the premier public high schools in Queens. And I graduated NYU not too long ago, and have spent my entire professional life working in public service as the chief of staff to an assembly member. I'm running in the 25th Assembly District that represents, hopefully to represent, parts of South Flushing, all the way from Fresh Meadows to Hillcrest, Auburndale, and parts of Bayside Hills. I'm looking to continue all of the good work that I've started in the Assembly, whether it is work on behalf of tenants, anti-guns, and on work on behalf of immigrant communities. I really have a couple of priorities that you would indulge me just for 1 second. I would like to outline
30 seconds.
Whether it is, you know, campaign finance reform, or raising the minimum wage, or making our education system what it needs to be so that students are competitive, not only for college, but for the workplace thereafter. Those are some of the things that we really, really need to prioritize in the state legislature, and that I am ready, willing, able to roll up my sleeves and get to work on. You know, it really takes strong champions to go to Albany and to make things happen. We have a great opportunity
to
shake
things
up. Okay,
thank you, Ms. Project.
And I'm looking forward to doing that.
Okay. As I mentioned at the start, Senator Avella does need to get going. I didn't want him to miss the lightning round. You guys must be channeling Jim Lehrer, because that first question took like 15 minutes to answer. So let's try to keep this moving. Before we get to the next question, Aaron, why don't we move right to, because like I said, Tony's got to leave. So pick your best lightning round question and fire it away.
Just one.
The best.
Gee, thanks. And again, and if it's a full disclosure, Senator Avella did say in advance he had to get going when he booked this event. But you guys too, don't hold back.
So for a lightning round question.
Go ahead, John.
Do you support Mayor Bloomberg's ban on large sugary drinks?
Absolutely not.
Senator?
No, just Tony, because he's got to go. Save some for the rest of the crowd. Okay. Bob, do you have one? Aaron?
Do you believe that there should be term limits in the New York State Assembly and Senate?
Yes, I actually introduced the first term limits bill in the Senate last year.
Great. One more from you, John. One more done.
Have you used a Metro card in the last 2 weeks?
Yes. I have it in my wallet. I want to see it.
John?
Does it have to be lightning round?
There's one
pointed question I had for both you, Senator Avella, and for Mr. Concannon.
Go ahead. I know where you're going.
There was a story we ran yesterday on New York One. I'd like you both to address it, some background. Senator Avella, you attended a Muslim Day parade 2 weeks ago. Mr. Concannon, you are running robocalls. You're calling people.
Contrasting,
and that's one way to put it. And I'll read a snippet from the robocall, and then if you can explain what you mean in the robocall, and then if you can respond to what the assertion in that call is. The robocall says, did you know that Tony Avella went to Manhattan to support a radical Islamic preacher who supports anti-American ideologies last week? Do you believe he supports this preacher who is anti-American, and if so, tell us why?
Well, I don't think Mr. Avella would get engaged in anything which he wasn't fairly well informed about. He was a Grand Marshal of the parade. He sat through the first speaker in this particular parade, who basically tore the U.S. Constitution into shreds, and that wasn't enough. He went into the second speaker, and he remained there. As that speaker started talking about all sorts of, and I don't recall it, you know, word for word, but I mean, it was something about bellies and her bomb and tying bombs on and things of this nature. And then he finally got up and he left. And then when he was asked to comment on it, he didn't want to spoil the party for anybody else. So, you know, I'm contrasting that. If that's, you know, he's got a district in Eastern Queens. If he wanted to go to the Muslim Day parade, well, hats off to him. Let him go march in a parade. All right? It's nowhere near his district, and I don't know what kind of impact it would have in this district. But that's part of the contrast. So, you know, if that's who he wants to hang around with, then I'm going to point that out.
Senator Avella.
You know, I find the robocall that was done, and you only mentioned a small part of it, extremely racist. Extremely racist. He not only, in effect, had racial overtones against African Americans, against Muslims, and against Koreans. This is not the way a campaign should be conducted. We should be talking about the issues. And he's actually going around in the neighborhood, because I've had people call me how upset they are about this robocall, that I shouldn't have even attended the Muslim parade. Well, Mr. Concannon should know that there are Muslims in this Senate district, there are Muslims in this city who are Americans. And they have the same wishes and desires that the rest of us have. And I'm happy I went to the parade, and I think it was appropriate that I walked out when anti-American, anti-Israel, and anti-Semitic comments were being made. And I would do exactly the same thing again. And as far as I'm concerned, Mr. Concannon should be ashamed of himself.
And just to follow up to each of you, you're running a campaign, both of you, that obviously has some significant differences. Can you say something nice about your opponent, each of you?
About Tony?
About Tony, yeah. And then in the reverse.
I've set it out on the stump. I think he's done, I guess, marginally better than he was as a city councilman in constituent services. He was, of course, was last in the city of all the city council members with constituent services, and I think he's improved over that.
I'll allow you to respond to that. And then
I don't know where he gets this stuff, to be perfectly honest. I think he makes this stuff up as he goes along. I have to, you know, and I think anybody in politics will tell you I have one of the best constituent services office, not only in the city council, but no offense, Toby, but I think we have a very good constituent, a very good constituent office. Anybody who calls my office gets help, whether they live in my district, or they live in another borough, or even if they live outside the city. As far as Joe Concannon, I appreciate his service as a police officer and as a member of the FBI.
And I think that's...
Okay. Tony, how about 1 minute closing remarks, and then we'll let you get on your way.
Well, you know, first of all, I want to thank St. John's University for, again, having this. And I do apologize for leaving, but there are other candidates' nights that have been scheduled for tonight. It has been my privilege and honor to serve in the City Council for 8 years and now a year and a half in the State Senate. To do what I think is right, no matter what the political consequences are. And I think that's important. And I think it's equally important for other legislators to adopt the same approach. I've tried to be an outspoken person in the City Council and now in the State Senate. I think we need more people speaking out about what goes on in Albany and how to improve government, and I'll continue to do that as long as I receive your support. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom. Mr. Concannon, no pun intended, if you want to move to your left, it has
that's
the functioning microphone. So that might be better, you want to say where you are?
I'm on the phone.
Okay.
I'm fine.
No
thank you very much. I'm actually going to the same event.
Okay.
So.
Harris, take it away.
So this is more of a general question that I think that a lot of students really watching the political spectrum are concerned with. In our ever-polarizing world, how would you, as a member of a particular side of the aisle, reach across to support or create bipartisan legislation or to really conserve your constituents in a bipartisan way? And we'll just start.
I've done it. As chair of the Higher Ed Committee, I reported out almost as many Republican bills as Democratic bills, which is very unusual, because a bill is a good bill regardless of who the sponsor is. We co-sponsor bills in the Senate in a totally bipartisan manner. I think it was Mayor LaGuardia who said there's no Republican or Democratic way to pick up the garbage, and I think we have to keep that concept in mind. But at the same time, we have two political parties which are becoming increasingly polarizing. And you see this, I think, particularly in Washington, where so many moderate legislators, particularly from the Republican Party, chose not to run for re-election. I mean, Olympia Snowe is a good example, a decent person, somebody whom they turned to. When we were working on the legislation to deal with the issue of the expiring co-op tax abatement, we worked with the mayor's office, particularly Assemblyman Braunstein and I worked with the mayor's office, but also with the Senate Republicans to try to come up with a compromise. And then we eventually did. Unfortunately, the bill was held up because of some procedural difficulties, the issue has been resolved, but it was resolved in a bipartisan manner. The third point I want to make is that we had a redistricting process that was the most polarizing political experience I've ever seen. And I think that kind of issue has to be resolved. We cannot be so partisan. And I think that's going to change, particularly under Governor Cuomo, who has made an effort to endorse both Republicans and Democrats. And we can work together. And I think it depends on the electorate voting for people who have the ability to walk across the aisle and say, let's solve the problem.
I would like to just piggyback on what Senator Stavisky is saying. You know, as the chief of staff in the state assembly, I learned very early on that if you grab hold of an issue and really push for it, it doesn't matter if you're a Democrat or a Republican, if you have a great issue that deserves the attention and deserves, you know, mention and pushing it through the state legislature, it is possible. And whether you're working with a Republican Senate, which I've had to deal with, and a Democratic Senate for, you know, the brief moment that it was in Democratic control, or whether you're working with your Republican colleagues within the state assembly to move a bill through committees and into, finally into law, it is possible, even in the dysfunction that is Albany. I've seen it over, you know, the tenure of 6 years working for Brian Kavanaugh. I passed, or, you know, I was helpful in passing over 20 bills into law, and that includes, you know, bills that we sponsored with a Republican Senate. Whether it's, you know, trying to fight gun violence or trying to push back against hospital closures, it doesn't matter if you are a Republican or a Democrat. You know, we all know, Republican or Democrat, we all know someone who has been affected by the DREAM Act and who just wants to stay in America. Those are the issues that we can find common ground on, and that is what I would you know, continue to do in the state assembly, working with colleagues on both sides of the aisle, in both chambers, and with the governor to just keep that going.
I should inform everybody here that for 23 years here in the city of New York, I have never once asked anyone whether they were a Republican, a Democrat, an Independent, a Working Families Party, a member of a Communist Party, Socialist, a blank, or anything else. Basically, what I've done is I've responded to people as a paid employee of the city of New York, whatever their need was. I've actually held the life of a young baby coming right out of mom, as well as I've held the life of a man, a retired police officer, on his last breath. So I have experienced the full cycle of life from beginning to end, and that knows no red or blue or anything else for that regard. So I would think that my ability to cross the aisle, I've actually had some informal talks with other leaders here in Queens, that it's about getting things done for the district. District 11, the 7th district in Eastern Queens, has 318,000 people with a variety of different needs. And at the end of the day, what it is all about is not alienating yourself so much so that you can't get a bill passed in Albany or you can't get funding into your district. What it's all about is helping those teachers fulfill the needs in the classroom, helping the district get roads paved, get buildings taken care of, and getting things like the Alley Pond Environmental Center up and running and fluid with cash so that the kids, the hundreds and thousands of children that go through that environmental center, can actually continue to learn how to protect our environment in sound, reasonable ways. You know, to do other programs like the Bayside Historical Society where we live, and to make sure that they get the proper funding, to make sure that our senior centers and other people out there in the district get funding. That's what bipartisanship can do. And I've been doing that all my career without really asking anyone whether they were a Republican or not. All right, and without isolating myself or my Senate seat, and without alienating myself, not only from Democrats, but also from my fellow Republicans. All right, so, you know, we may not agree on every issue, we may be off on the politics, but when it comes to getting things down and done for the community, that's what it's all about. getting things done for the community. And that's what people have counted on me to do in the police department and in the Giuliani administration. And I'm the go-to guy to get that done, and I'll get it done for the people in the 11th Senatorial District.
Mr. Fuchs.
Recently, I was invited by Planned Parenthood to interview with them. And in Republican circles, Planned Parenthood is a boogeyman. And that's not the way I see it. Barry Goldwater was pro-choice, by the way. And I sent in the questionnaire. I came to interview, and I did learn something very, very interesting and crucial from them. That in New York State, the law about abortion is on the criminal code, and there is no health provision for the mother. And that means that after 24 weeks, if there is a major health complication with a mother, a doctor in New York State does not have the right to order an abortion. There can be major complications. What doctors in New York State have to do is send the patient to another state. So I would say that in terms of getting along with the other side, two words come to mind: fair hearing. The idea is to give the other side a fair hearing. On the other hand, after my session was almost over with them, I did ask them to what extent they emphasize adoption in their organization, and whether they stress to their clients the idea that women can often have guilt and remorse when after they've gone through an abortion, because women have a nature of nurturing life, and an abortion can go against their nature. I'm not saying for everyone, but the idea is that if these women offered their baby for adoption, people wouldn't have to go to Russia and Romania and India to adopt.
All right, Mr. Kim, back to the original question, if you can.
Yes, Aaron. Even though I'm Asian American, I've been fortunate to, have not experienced that much discrimination in my life. That is, until I decided to run as a Republican for state senate, and I'm actually dead serious about that. I'm actually very stunned at all the negativity towards Republicans. And sure, there are some evil Republicans who only look out for rich people. You know, I'm not one of them. But in any case, there's a good book out right now by Bob Woodward that I think is called The Price of Politics or something like that. So actually I was very interested I'm not done with it yet, but the reason why I find it interesting is because it actually broke some of the notions that I had in my head. I tell you, reading a book, all the characters, all the entities actually came across as more reasonable than I had previously thought, including Speaker Boehner and Eric Cantor. You know, people think Eric Cantor is this evil Tea Party guy, and sure he's done his share of obstruction, but he came across as more reasonable than I thought. So I guess all hope is not lost, but definitely, as was said several times here, I think the country is headed in the wrong direction. I think we definitely need to work more together. So let's do that.
Okay, I'm going to ask the panelists if they could flag a couple lightning round questions to Senator Stavisky and Mr. Concannon, are exiting early. But while you do that, there were some audience questions that were submitted to particular candidates, and I want to get them in before they leave. For Senator Stavisky, and give me your quickest answer as possible. How do you feel that remedial classes are not needed in college when some students come from areas where education is poorly funded and teachers don't have the materials or means to effectively do their jobs and must get information across as best they can, which sometimes doesn't get the job done?
It should be done at the high school and really elementary school level. I think college is not the place for remediation.
Okay.
Something like 70% of the students at the community colleges at CUNY need remediation. It used to be 80, it's down to 70. That's too high. Okay. In one of the three areas. I mean, that's a quick answer.
For Mr. Concannon, this came in for you. Do you suggest getting rid of extracurricular activities in schools at the elementary level or high school level if it is proven that these kids aren't performing well?
I don't promote getting rid of the programs. What I would do is I would focus my priorities, my funding priorities and all, on the center of education, which is the classroom and the teacher, making sure that the teacher and the classroom resources are there so that our students can learn the underlying, you know, reading, writing, and arithmetic. I think once we've perfected that, we can expand into a lot of different areas. But as you're hearing today, you know, a lot of the children are leaving our schools and they're not prepared for the workplace. All right, so we've got to get back to fundamentals and get back to the core mission of the New York City Board of Education.
Again, I don't want to then miss the opportunity of the lightning round, so if you guys are ready, just pose them to Senator Stavisky and Mr. Concannon. Bob?
I have one for Mr. Concannon. It's not from the list. It's a broader question. You talked about smaller and more effective government. Can you give us a couple of programs in New York State that you think we can cut or have to get rid of as part of the smaller, more effective government?
Well, I think we should go no further than the MTA. They seem to be my favorite. The MTA knows no ends and no bounds to the size of its budget and to its zealousness for eating up tax dollars like you can't believe. And they are front and center on the front pages, I'm sure, with our friends over at New York One and the rest of the media as well. They're coming in once again, looking for more money, more money, more money. All right, let's streamline the MTA and teach them what computers can do and teach them how to better more and more efficiently and more effectively conduct their operations. I'm not for slimming down their operations, but what I am in favor of is slimming down their overall bureaucracy. And I think we can save millions of dollars in doing that. And that's really where I want to go. I tell you, you know, one thing that really ticked me off, and this isn't a short answer, but it has to do with the MTA's runaround on the citizens of the downstate region of New York State. And you probably know about this, the MTA rollback tax. What they did, you know, once they found out that everybody was going to protest about the bridges, tunnels, and everything else, all right, somehow they got this tax that came in on every single downstate resident. Unfair, people didn't even know it was there. All right, and now, of course, it's being challenged, and there's a counter challenge going to that. And I think if that can get completely rolled back, that would be a good thing.
I'll ask some lightning round questions, because they're fun. Should the office of borough president be eliminated? For you and then for Senator Sitovich?
Yes or no? No,
yeah.
Maybe.
Yes
no
or no?
Pass.
No.
No.
Should Shelley Silver be reelected as the assembly speaker?
Absolutely not.
Each house determines its own leadership, and that's up to the assembly.
Not a yes or no answer.
I can't answer a yes or no because we have no jurisdiction there.
Okay.
If you ask me about John Sampson or whatever, that's a totally different issue.
Yeah, well, I want to ask both of the assembly candidates in a longer form after we lose these two guys. Will the Big East survive as the athletic home of St. John's University? Does the Big East have any future as a conference, yes or no?
Big what?
The Big East, yeah. Do you think it'll survive as a athletic conference?
Can I say I hope so?
Sure. Senator Stavisky?
I have no idea.
Fair enough. Another
Although question. I did attend at one of my university left, I think is leaving the Big East.
She went to Syracuse.
I went to Syracuse.
She's an Orangeman.
Yeah.
Would you publicly say that you 100% support your party's candidate for president?
I do.
Do you support using a merit pay system for teachers?
Do I what?
Support using a merit pay system for teachers.
Yeah, merit pay would be good.
No.
Okay.
Okay, Senator Stavisky, 1 minute closing remarks, and then Mr. Concannon.
I want to expand on everything.
I got the watch going.
Okay. As I said earlier, I feel privileged to have represented the 16th district for the past 12, almost 13 years. I think we've done a lot, but I think a lot has to be done. This is a very unique district, and I look forward to talking about these issues with Mr. Kim. I think that I think it's great that we have candidates who don't look like everybody else. It's time that we join the 20th century and elect people. We have a diverse team in Flushing right now. We have Grace Meng in the Assembly, and we had Peter Koo, and I represent a different segment of the population, and that's what Queens is about. It's about diversity. And I'm proud to be part of the diverse team in Flushing, and I think we've accomplished a great deal in Flushing, particularly in terms of the economic development, but I think that there's a lot more that has to be done.
Good evening, everybody, and thanks for coming tonight. We certainly appreciate it. My name is Joseph Concannon. I've spent a career in public service protecting your right to say whatever you would like, whenever you'd like to say it, anywhere here in the city of New York, and I would defend that to the death as I have on many, many different occasions and demonstrations here in the city of New York. I look forward to this continued dialogue over the next 27 days in the campaign, and I look forward to meeting Senator Avella at each one of these events and mixing it up. I'd say the only shortcoming of tonight is some of the empty seats I see upstairs. I wish we did have a fuller crowd in here because I do believe in open and transparent conversation for everybody. I wish each and every one of you have a great night tonight. I wish I could stay a lot longer. Some of my interns will tell you I love a great dialogue with the students. They've got some very fresh ideas, and that's really what I'm all about, bringing in some new ideas into government and everywhere else. I have to be off to another debate, which Senator Vella's got about 20 minutes leap on me, and otherwise I'd say. Otherwise, thank you very much, and hopefully we'll see you on the campaign trail.
Thank you. As soon as they leave, we're going to bolt the doors. Somebody else can go. Bob, you want to pick it up where we left off?
I wanted to ask Mr. Rozic. Was he playing on the question that was asked before about Shelley Silver and not making it that personal to Shelley Silver?
Sure.
Are there things about the way the New York State Assembly operates in terms of its leadership, in terms of the way how it holds up in
sure.
your body to the speaker, that you might want to change?
Absolutely. So I learned firsthand working in the State Assembly that it is quite dysfunctional. You know, the Brennan Center gave it the title of one of the most, if not the most dysfunctional state legislatures in America. And whether you're talking about how seniority-based it is, or how leadership driven it is, there are a lot of different things that we can change. What I'm excited about is that I offer a different perspective. Even, you know, if you're talking about what happened over the summer with a lot of the scandals that have been happening, you know, I offer, as a former female staffer and a young person, a different voice, a different perspective, and one that Albany desperately needs. You know, we do need to change Albany, and whether it's campaign finance reform so that smaller contributions and more individuals can get excited about government and get involved and run for office, or you're talking about smaller campaign finance reform or election reform bills that we can pass through the Assembly, there's a lot to do and a lot that has yet to be done. So I'm looking forward to getting to Albany, rolling up my sleeves, and working on those bills. And also just offering a different perspective, like I mentioned before. You know, you have to work in a bipartisan way, you have to work with your colleagues. But I think that the number one way to change Albany is to send rank and file members who will go to Albany and work on behalf of their community and work hard on issues that they care about. And that is the number one way to reform Albany.
If I could just piggyback off that for Mr. Fuchs, you would be a Republican member of the New York State Assembly from New York City. That is as minority comes, how would you do your job effectively as a Republican in the minority from the city in the state assembly? How would you be an effective advocate despite what might be an imbalance?
Again, it's a matter of giving everyone a fair hearing. It's about considering the merit of the argument. For instance, I buck my party in terms of tax structure. I believe that with the great disparity in income and in wealth between the rich and the poor, the middle class is vanishing. The wealth class has multiplied its portion by 15 times over the middle class over the last 30 years. I believe that at this time, being that businesses are sitting on $2 trillion in cash, that rich people, wealthy people, should have a higher tax burden. And I agreed with President Obama about this a long time ago. And now it seems that Mitt Romney is kind of going on that also, idea of limiting deduct. I'm sorry.
So that's an idea that you don't hold a Republican point on or differ with your party. But to me, I'm asking more of a procedural question. How do you make your voice heard in a chamber where you're such a minority?
I assume they have microphones in the state assembly. And I would speak this the same way I'm speaking now. I mean, if anybody wants to hear me, I mean, if they want to walk out when I'm speaking, I don't have much of a choice other than to, you know, bar the door. But it's a matter of being fair, being reasonable, looking at common ground and checking your ego at the door.
I'd like to shift the focus to the New York State economy. What is one specific piece of legislation or one initiative that you would champion to promote economic growth, private sector investments, and job retention and growth in New York State? And do we want to start with Assemblyman Weprin?
Can you repeat the question? I thought you were directing over there.
What is one specific piece of legislation or one initiative that you would champion to promote economic growth, private sector investments, and job retention and growth in New York State?
Well, I actually have a chapter this past year on a biotechnology credit in the state of New York to give us an opportunity to compete with California and other jurisdictions in the biotech area. I think there's plenty of areas we could do tax credits, and actually that was a bill that passed both, I was a prime sponsor in the assembly, passed both houses and was signed by the governor a couple of months ago. But the film tax credit is another area where we've created jobs in the film industry in New York through that film tax credit. It was done both at the state level as well as the city level for films that have performed in New York City as well as New York State. Obviously, it's New York City. You got a New York City and New York State tax credit. And we actually expanded that program significantly because of the huge success in creating new industry, expanding a new industry, the film industry. Steiner Studios in Brooklyn is relatively new. We've expanded in Queens with Astoria Films and other film studios in Queens. So clearly, that's an industry we've made a conscious effort to expand and create new jobs.
If you could just, we've been joined in progress by Assemblyman David Weprin. Assemblyman, I'll give you a little more time and we'll do closing remarks.
Sure.
To kind of balance out things. He's the Assemblyman from the 24th Assembly District, and the Queens campus is now located in his Assembly District.
Correct.
So we'll be seeing a lot more. He's been a regular here at all our candidate nights. I want to welcome you, and we'll give you more time towards the end.
No problem.
So there are two things that I want to highlight. The first is definitely raising the minimum wage, right? We have a great solution to helping out working families and working individuals, and we definitely need to raise the minimum wage. The second thing is, like I've mentioned before, the New York State Dream Act. You know, we need to keep smart people in New York. We need to keep immigrants and our neighbors who want to stay here. It's what our country was based on and what it was founded on. So those are the two proposals that I would say.
I think we can eliminate, excuse me, I think we can free up a lot of money if we reform the educational system. If people would be able to go send their kids to the schools of their choice, they would be able to find education for cheaper tuition, and that in other words, you give people more money and they create an economy. I'm not an expert in predicting which industries people should go to. I think that's a bad business, like President Obama, putting money in failing green energy businesses like Solyndra and others. I think the government cannot effectively predict which industries will do well. The idea is to free up money that the government is taking from the people and let the people, with their creativity, go into the businesses that are best suited for the marketplace. The idea is that the education, by funding $18,000 per pupil for state education, the state. The Archdiocese has tuition for elementary school at $4,000 and high school for $7,000. Now, if you allow people to educate their kids at those kind of tuitions and the state would be out of it, the state would be lessening the burden on people. And we would have more money for private industry.
Greg, I'm specifically not going to answer your question, if that's okay. And the reason I say that is because there's legislation, and then there's the real world. And when I go out and talk to businesses, you know, they are really upset right now because of all these what do you call it? You know, one thing I hear over and over again is, the city fails to pick up the trash on time, and then the wind blows the trash in front of them, and then they have to, you know, pause their business activities and go out and sweep. And if they fail to do that, they get fined. Also, the restaurant grading system, I've heard over and over again with the word they compare these city workers to a mafia racket. These, you know, young people come and they threaten them and say, oh, you know, you don't get an A this time. You have to pay thousands of dollars. You know, and the reason I say all this is because I think that, you know, small businesses are on the front line of saving the economy, because, you know, small businesses create jobs, people have jobs, they stay in their homes, you know, and there's enough money for social programs as well. But I think that, you know, the government right now is nickeling and diming these small businesses and choking them so they can't grow properly. And also, I'll just say that, Flushing, which is, you know, I think somebody mentioned it, I'll save that for a later answer. I'm sure it'll come up. I think there's plenty we need to do to unshackle the businesses right now before we even get into more legislation. So.
This is a question for all of you. Richard Ravitch, who's part of a report recently, talked about the fact that New York local governments in New York State were really threatened with substantial social and political crises with the funding problems that they're having in this economy. A lot of mayors, and I know probably you've heard this during the February hearings, a lot of mayors and local people will come up and complain to the state legislature about the mandates, 15% of Medicaid costs, and all these other things that are pushed from Albany to local governments. Could you address that issue of the impending crisis that Ravitch sees the local government area in New York, and what New York State can do to help this instead of exacerbating the problem?
Why don't we start with Mr. Kim and work our way down?
Darn it. I always had more time to think of an answer, but and watch how lost I am without that extra time. But I'll admit I'm not as familiar with that area. But I'll just leave it at that for now. Thank you.
As far as the mandates, we as citizens don't really have open access to government, to the inner workings of government. If you try to look up what the budget is and different programs, you'll just swim around in a bunch of factoids and all that. Government has to be more transparent, more open. Audits, we talk about waste in government. Well, I happen to think that government does a great job in terms of auditing its operations. It's another question whether they take effective action on the audits, but I think the audits are great. I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but if like Mr. Concannon was mentioning MTA, if they audited and they presented these audits in a user-friendly way, we could see where our tax money is going and where why all these mandates are being pushed onto the city. It comes down to money. And where is the money? How is it being used? And is it really necessary? To go back to education, I think there's tremendous waste in education. We don't know. I mean, the teachers get a certain amount of it, and then $18,000 for pupil. Where does all that money go? So basically, it comes down to transparent government.
So not only did the former lieutenant governor have that great report, but also the New York Times did a whole series on local governments and how crippled they are. Unfunded mandates are crippling a lot of the cities upstate, and out on Long Island, localities are in severe deficits. If not now, then in 5 and 10 years. It's definitely something we need to work on in Albany. We've got a great governor who will lead on that issue, and I look forward to working with both him and both the Senate and the Assembly on that topic.
Yes, there's no question that mandate relief for local governments is a problem. Governor Cuomo did appoint a mandate relief task force, which came out with a number of recommendations, which came around the same time that the legislature passed the property tax cap. There were a lot of local governments that were against the property tax cap, although a lot of their citizens were worried about the increasing property taxes, and most of the constituents of local governments were happy with the property tax cap. The actual mayors and county executives and local government officials were not, because it limited their flexibility. If they could not raise property taxes more than 2%, there were a lot of budget needs that they had, and the legislature did provide them flexibility in going to the bond market, allowing them additional opportunities for deficit financing, to refinance their debt. So there were a number of mandate relief recommendations that came along, and also exceptions to the property tax cap. So there were a number of proposals that came out of that mandate relief task force, and some of them have been implemented, others are being phased in, others are going to be discussed at the upcoming legislative session.
Okay, before we get to John's next question, I do want to remind the audience, if you have questions, there's index cards going around. I would like to get a couple more. If you have any questions, then we'll try to get as many of them answered. John.
I'm going to ask a targeted question of Mr. Weprin. You're running unopposed, yeah?
Yes, you have a choice to vote for me on the Democratic line, the Independence Party line, or the Working Family Party line.
Right, so I want to go back to your last election for a second.
Okay.
The special election against Bob Turner. Do you regret running for Congress?
Not at all. Not at all. It was. I regret the outcome. I think the voters made a mistake, but I was very happy to be the Democratic nominee. It was a very exciting time in our country's history. There were a lot of major issues that were facing the country at that time and still are facing the country, and I thought I could have made a significant contribution had I served in the House this last year and a half, but I have no regrets.
Just coming back to Ms. Rozic for one second, if you win, will you vote for Shelton Silver, to be the speaker again?
You know what, I'm not sure. You know,
well, how did you feel he handled it?
There's an investigation pending, and I would really like to see the results of JCO and what they find out and go from there.
Mr. Fuchs, do you, we hear a lot about the minimum wage. Do you support raising the minimum wage? Is that something you think is a good idea?
I do think it's a good idea with qualifications. Not every company should be subjected to the minimum wage. I think a certain size company should be subject to the minimum wage. Yes, but exemptions for smaller companies.
Mr. Kim, there's a lot of development going on in Flushing, the area right around Citi Field, now possibly an MLS stadium. The USTA is looking to expand. They want to build a mall at Willits Point. What do you think the future of Willits Point should be right next to Citi Field?
Do you mind if I answer the minimum wage question first?
You can answer, you know what, just hit whatever one you
sure.
want. That's not just throwing it out there.
No, I actually had a new idea that I hadn't heard anywhere else. The reality is, definitely it's hard for a family to live on the minimum wage, but, there are also situations where you're not intended to live on the minimum wage, like students or part-time work. So I think a new idea is to lower the minimum wage for specific categories, like students or part-time workers. So that that might clarify things a little bit. But
you want to lower the minimum wage?
You can also lower or raise, but I'm saying, students and part-time workers are in a different category. So it could technically go even lower for them, and maybe even raise it for the rest, for people who need to make a living off of it. You know what I'm saying?
I got it. I'm done.
Great. Go ahead. Take it away.
This question is for Assemblyman Weprin. Multiple hospitals have closed in Queens County alone. Why is this happening, and what is the state government doing about it?
Well, part of the problem, I think, is that the state and the federal government over the last couple of years have reduced funding, for Medicaid reimbursement and other reimbursements that the hospitals relied on to help pay their bills. So they've had cuts at both the city level, the state level, and the federal level, and that's created a crisis in the delivery of medical services, in our area. You point out correctly, a number of hospitals have closed. In some cases, there have been some health clinics and other delivery of the services, at the local level. But there's no question that we need more medical facilities, and we have to find a way to finance them, to pay for them. I don't think it's a question of a lack of, medical need. There's no question that, that there are still people that are very much in need of the medical services, but it's become a problem. There have been a number of mergers as well. I'd like to see, right here in Queens, we have, Queens Hospital Center, which is part of New York City Health and Hospitals, which has become a state-of-the-art facility. They have a state-of-the-art cancer institute and state-of-the-art equipment that's expanded significantly over the last couple of years, the public hospital system, and I think provides quality care. But I would like to see more hospitals opening at the local level and providing competition as well.
Erin.
Sure. This question is specifically for Ms. Rozic and Mr. Fuchs. What ideas do you have to bring business right here locally to Union Turnpike and the rest of your district, where we're seeing so many vacancies and it's right in our own neighborhood? So,
I grew up two blocks away from Union Turnpike, and increasingly over the years, you see all of these empty storefronts going up and never getting built. I'm still waiting for my hair salon to still open. So there's a lot that we can do, whether it's tax credits for small businesses or encouraging new tech services and new industries to move into Eastern Queens. We need to show businesses that Eastern Queens is the place to be, that it's easily accessible with transit, and it's a place that people not only want to open their businesses, but keep their businesses here. I also want to ask the audience really quick, is anyone here tweeting the event? Because I will also take questions via Twitter. I think it's a younger crowd, and if people want to get involved, like, that's a great way to do it.
And your Twitter handle is?
At Nily.
N-I-L-L-Y.
N-I-L-Y.
N-I-L-Y. Mr.
Fuchs. I really wouldn't be able to help you out with recommendations for our local, Union Turnpike. But I would say that money is fungible, and when you establish a system where money flows, it finds its niche. It finds its like water finds its level. If people had more money, I guarantee you Union Turnpike would be full. And there are two ways how people can have more money, and it happens either from reducing government waste, which I talked about before in terms of, again, my pet thing about education. I mean, and the reason I say that is because a lot of people who are paying private tuition and paying their property tax are really, really squeezed. These people would have money to set up businesses and to provide economic activity. And the other way is to shift the burden from the middle class taxes. In other words, give even more. Yeah, I'm going against a Republican establishment here. That the wealthy can bear a heavier burden in taxes, and let the middle class have more money to spend on products and services. And when the middle class has more money to spend on products and services, Union Turnpike will be full.
This is a question for Mr. Weprin and Ms. Rozic. Part of the preparation Brian Brown did for this, and he always does a great job on this, is he gave us a handout. And one of the things he says here is that since 1960, U.S. job growth has been four times that in New York State. Based on this experience, it's obvious we need to improve the state's overall economic climate. Now, I'm asking the two Democrats this question for this reason. The Republicans will tell us we need to cut taxes. Regardless of the issues, sometimes, but certainly on business climate. What's the Democratic policy? What are your ideas as to how to keep New York State from turning into Arkansas, which upstate New York may very well, in terms of development and economic growth through Democratic Party politics?
We've actually cut taxes in New York State significantly, and believe it or not, it's been under the Democrats. I think it was under Republicans, the taxes were much higher. We've lowered significantly the top rate, over the last 10 years. And now at this point, we probably have, other than below $2 million, because we did increase slightly the taxes for people making over $2 million, not less than $2 million, we probably have one of the lowest state tax rates, in 30 or 40 years. So. There's no question that we have cut taxes, and it's been done most recently under Democrats. There's no question that we have to encourage new industries in New York State. The governor has been very proactive in putting together summits. You may have read he just had a yogurt summit in Albany, where we've created a number of new yogurt companies that have opened up in New York, expanded in New York. The dairy industry is a major industry in upstate New York that's expanded. We have to encourage those type of industries, as well as, you know, biotech, as I mentioned earlier, and the film industry, and many other industries. So I think it's a question of creating jobs and trying to create jobs in New York State. And I also am a co-sponsor of increasing the minimum wage, which I think will help as well in New York State.
Excuse me, how do you counter the argument that increasing minimum wage drives jobs out? Is this a market argument we're hearing a lot? Living wage, minimum wage drives jobs.
Speak close to the microphone, please.
Just how do you counter the argument that the minimum wage or living wage or any kind of wage established by government drives jobs out?
I've heard that argument. I don't think statistics bear that out. I think you'll find that the people at that low level end up spending the money and putting it right back into the economy immediately. People that are living on living wage, are living paycheck to paycheck, they're barely making ends meet, and any extra money that they're going to be making by the increase will be immediately put into the economy at the local level. They'll be buying more food, they'll be buying more more drugs, medications. They'll be buying more clothes. I think the money will be put then it's not going to go into savings, it's going to go right into spending.
Could I just clarify?
I think it was directed to Ms. Rozic, though.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
So, as I mentioned before, raising the minimum wage would be one of them. Having paid sick leave in New York would be another viable solution. And also, in addition to encouraging new industries, we can get a lot more done if government is open and transparent, if things are, easier and out in the open. I think that's one of the many ways that we can be encouraging new industries and actually having a real discussion on economic development in New York State. And just to answer the question about raising the minimum wage and driving out jobs, we've seen studies in San Francisco and Milwaukee, but that's just not true, that it actually helps the local industries. So.
Did you want to clarify something?
Yeah, I just wanted, first of all, very, very sorry about that. I didn't mean to, Andrew.
No,
I was just saying, as I was saying earlier about, actually lowering, the minimum wage for part-time and student workers, if you look at the system as a whole, that enables, businesses to raise the wages for, for regular workers who need it. There's a balance there. Do you know what I'm saying? So that's just what.
So you just want to clarify, you're in favor of lowering the minimum wage for students and increasing it for other folks?
Yes. And that would actually help businesses to function more better.
Okay. John, your turn.
Erin really wants to follow up on something. I see it on her face.
Go ahead, Erin.
I just have a quick follow-up. So how do you propose that, I guess you believe that students do not need the money as much as other people. Is that correct? And just clarifying, so that's why you would propose lowering their wages?
Well, first of all, my wife has taught me not to argue with women. So, but I would just very respectfully say that absolutely. When I was a student, I worked as well. That's when I washed dishes and enjoyed it very much. But I think, respectfully, there is a difference, though. A student, while certain students need the money as much, maybe we need yet another category. But, but definitely not, the student need is not the same as somebody who needs to support their livelihood and their families with that minimum wage, is my point.
So I guess my question would be then, what would you propose to lower the burden on students who are putting themselves through college and especially through schools as tuition continually increases?
Yeah, that is a very valid problem. And I'm still paying off my student loans myself. So, and as I said, as a society, We've built this up, this whole machine, this monster of higher education, and absolutely those costs have to come down. So, yeah.
John, your turn. So in Queens over the past, let's call it 10 years, we've had a number of elected officials arrested, many imprisoned, some still in prison. What will you do if you're elected, and when you're elected, what do you do to make sure that your office is as transparent and open, I've heard that a couple times, to your constituents? How do you make sure that constituents know exactly what you're doing once you're elected? And we can start with Mr. Fuchs.
Obviously, you're referring to legal activity, because the illegal activity is going to be under the table anyway, right? Right?
Yeah, I mean, yes, but if you just for, if I'm going to pick one case out of, well, off the top of my head, let's, Shirley Huntley had a nonprofit that was getting money from the state, and then that ended her up in a little bit of trouble. So my question to you, and it's a broad question, how do you make your office transparent in general? I would hope that all your activities would be transparent, but how do you make your office transparent to your constituents? How do you keep them informed of what you're doing on a daily basis, where your member allocations go, that kind of thing?
I don't know why this should be so complicated in the world of politics. Right now, when we're candidates, we have to account for every penny that we spend on campaign finance. I mean, you know, every deadline comes around and you have to fill in that report. If Shirley Huntley is being financed from a nonprofit, that nonprofit, whatever money, sorry.
Yeah, no, I'm just asking like a concrete example on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, on a monthly basis, what will you do as an assembly member to keep your constituents informed of what you're doing?
There has to be a system. It's not just a matter of one person, what they're doing. There has to be a system where, every transaction that comes from your office, what you're funding, who's donating or has a business with your department, has to be transparent, has to be documented.
So let's say an interest group comes into your Albany office and says, I want to meet with you, and it's a group that supports hydrofracking. Will you put on your website, I met today with the pro hydrofracking lobby of America, or will you not tell your constituents? How open would you be with your constituents?
Well, to meet with a lobby is just a matter of being educated. In theory, it shouldn't matter whether you're reading a book or whether you're meeting a person. In each case, you're being educated about a certain aspect of the world that you're trying to legislate. But in terms of activity, yes, any activity that you do, any monies going back and forth should be documented.
Okay, that's fair. Ms. Rosen.
Clearly, my opponent doesn't actually know how an office functions. You, first and foremost, to have an open and transparent office, have to believe in open and transparency, not only in your Albany office, but in your district office as well. That means having a mobile office, that means having staff available in native languages to address constituent needs. That means having hotlines available 24/7, whether you have a housing issue or an immigration issue. Those are things that I would do as an assemblywoman. We haven't had member items at the state level in the past couple of cycles, but if they were to come back, you know, I believe in participatory budgeting, having open hearings, hearing from different organizations throughout the community about what the priorities are, addressing them with the input of the local community. You know, in terms of meeting with folks, Senator Gillibrand has posted all of her meetings online. that's definitely an interesting proposal. I've never actually seen anyone do it in Albany, and that's definitely something to take into consideration. I would always have my office open, as often as we can, and I really, like I mentioned before, I believe in mobile office. Like, if you can't make it to Union Turpik and Utopia Parkway, you should have a mobile office that comes to you at least once a month, if not more. Those are some of the proposals that I would do as an assemblywoman, ones that I've worked on as a chief of staff and would continue to do so.
Sure, Kim.
There's an old Marlon Brando movie, Viva Zapata, and this is my favorite scene of all time. First, Marlon Brando is a peasant revolutionary, and he visits the president at his desk, the president, gives him a lot of nonsense, Later on, Marlon Brando's character, becomes the president, and he's sitting at his desk, and a peasant revolutionary comes to him and complains, and he's blowing him off. Then he finally realizes that he turned into the very thing that he despised. And so the best scene ever, he gets up, he grabs his rifle off the wall, and he heads back out into the fields. So my point is, not just to tell, story, but my point is, every time they pass a regulation like McCain-Feingold or whatever it is, politicians always find a way around it. And I think the only real solution is to develop the leadership and the morals in students, and they go out and do better. That's why this cycle, I'm trying to run a very different campaign, and I'm trying to just keep that Marlon Brando in the back of my head. But this, there are common sense laws that can be passed that do help, but like I said, basically it comes down to the moral fiber of our leaders.
So. Okay, well, quickly. Newsletters, more newsletters, more targeted newsletters to different communities. For example, I've done a number of senior directed mailings as well as district-wide mailings. Town hall meetings, more town hall meetings, directed town hall meetings to specific communities. About 2-3 weeks ago, I had New Immigrant Connect catering to the South Asian community. My new assembly district is heavily South Asian. It's over 30%. Possibly South Asian. It's hard to figure out the statistics because they're all part of the Asian category, but I have a number of new immigrants, a very diverse district, and I've made a significant outreach to that new community, particularly the Indian, Bangladeshi, Pakistani community, and kind of a job forum to and information on different state agencies that are available to them. I sponsored a bill in Albany, which didn't pass, but I'm hoping to push again to require all three main South Asian languages in Queens on the election material, on the ballot itself. Right now, there's one language, and they weren't even in time on that one, and I think they may be backtracking on Bengali. But I sponsored requiring all three languages. But basically just more outreach.
Okay, with the 15 minutes we have left, we want to get to the lightning round. We want to get to audience questions and closing remarks. So if you guys want to flag some lightning round questions, I'm going to pose some of these questions that came in from the audience, and then we'll move right to the lightning round. All right, this came from the audience, and it's anyone, and probably just a yes or no question. Do you support caps on non-economic damages in civil suits? Do you support caps on non-economic damages in civil suits, Mr. Weber?
I do not.
Ms. Rozic?
I don't.
Mr. Fuchs?
I do.
You do? Mr. Kim?
I do.
Okay. Another question that came in from the audience, and this one is directed to all the candidates. How would you work to help unions, educators, city workers, transit, etc., keep their strength in bargaining, while at the same time help government manage balancing the books without breaking unions' backs? All right, so collective bargaining, unions. Mr. Kim. How would you work to help unions in the collective bargaining process without breaking the unions' back and keeping in mind the fiscal constraints on government?
Yeah, there too. I mean, I tend to look at things holistically. There's a system there. And so, you know, workers definitely need to be protected and be organized. And on the other hand, you know, government, and if you're talking, you know, businesses and corporations also, you know, obviously need to make a profit. So I think it, you know, it comes down to, you know, the issues of you know, partisanship, bipartisanship that we're talking about. I think if both sides, you know, be reasonable, and you know, there's always, you know, as you're, you know, and this actually applies to the issues of corruption too. As you're living, you know, you go about your business, you go about your work, and then the temptations arise to, you know, veer off. You know, so I think just in keeping the public good in mind, reasonableness in mind, I think, you know, that will do a lot of good.
Mr. Fuchs.
I think that unions should definitely have the right to collective bargaining. Maybe in fiscal emergencies, not. Government workers should not have the right to strike. There should be arbitration.
Everybody, all government workers.
Yes.
Okay, Sprouse.
So I'm being supported by a lot of the major labor unions, like 1199, the UFT, Teamsters, because they know that when I get to Albany, I'm going to be a champion for their family members, their issues. We really need to make sure that unions have their fair contracts and that we protect the Triborough Amendment. Now in this dire economic economy, we really, really need to be protecting our working families, not hurting them.
Yeah, I've been a strong supporter of organized labor for many years, my 8 years in the city council, my 3 years in the assembly. I think it's very important that workers have the right to collectively bargain, to negotiate in good faith, and I think the government as well as the private sector should negotiate in good faith, and I just support a strong union movement and collective bargaining.
Okay, last audience question, and if we can keep it quick. In Queens, district allocations are very limited to Asian Americans in ratio to the population. What can be done about it? In Queens, district allocations, I assume that's state government money, are very limited to Asian American in ratio to the population. What can be done about it?
Well, you know, the Asian American community is probably one of the largest growing communities in Queens, and I guess throughout the city. And we've done I've sponsored a number of programs and involved in a number of funding initiatives specifically geared to the new immigrant community, to the Asian community, to the South Asian community. I think we just need more programs, more assistance, more language translation. I think there has been. It's a large growing population, and we just have to, keep pace.
Okay, Ms. Rozic, if you can, quickly.
I'm just going to agree with the assumption.
Okay, Mr. Fuchs.
Is the contention that they need more allocation?
In ratio to the population, as the question was written, what can be done to provide more state allocations to the Asian American population?
Well, I don't know why the Asian population would be singled out in particular. Obviously, services are allocated according to the needs of populations in general.
Okay, Mr. Kim.
I would just argue or say real quickly that I think that Asians now are contributing more than their normal share, and perhaps at the same time receiving less than their fair share. So, you know, other than that, I agree with what Councilman Reverend said.
Favorite part of the evening, the lightning round? Yes or no only, no pass, no maybe, and I'll be the arbiter again of that. Mr. Mitchell, take it away.
Would you publicly say that you 100% support your party's candidate for president? Sorry,
yes.
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 All right.
Is Michael Bloomberg a better mayor than Rudy Giuliani?
I'm not a fan of.
Yes or no?
I would say yes.
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 You know, I would just say I'm getting scared now that, you know, Mayor Bloomberg is nearing the end of his term. I think both mayors totally changed the city. So I say yes to both of them.
John.
Is New York City better off now than it was 4 years ago? Assemblyman.
Yes.
Yes, especially in the legislature.
Yes.
All right, yes.
Who is the best president in American history?
Best president
in American history. I thought this was a yes or no.
We'll give moderators privilege, panelists privilege there. Go ahead. Best president.
Best president in United States history. Interesting. I'll say a Republican, Abraham Lincoln.
So there hasn't been a female president yet. So can I hold out for that one?
Mr. Fuchs.
Toss up between George Washington and Abe Lincoln, I don't know.
I would say the most misunderstood president and the one who has perhaps contributed the most to our modern era, Lyndon Johnson.
Do you support increased hydrofracking in New York State?
No.
Absolutely not.
Well, I support increase in hydrofracking for what?
In New York State.
In New York State. Well, there's a moratorium on fracking, so there is no fracking.
Would you support legislation to enact hydrofracking in New York State? Allow hydrofracking?
Question mark. It's still being reviewed.
Good. Not at this time.
Have you ever participated in a political demonstration?
Yes.
Yes.
No.
John,
would you support a wind farm off the Rockaway Peninsula within view of the Rockaway Peninsula? Assembly.
A what farm?
A wind farm. Wind energy.
Windmills.
A window.
Within view of the beaches of the Rockaways.
Off coast?
Off the coast, yeah. As was proposed.
Possibly.
So that's
weak. Hold on, yes or no?
Yes.
I'd say yes.
You said a wind farm?
Yeah, so they proposed a couple of years ago creating a wind farm.
Like windmills?
Windmills, yeah.
Windmills.
They're turbines.
Would you support that?
Outside of what?
Off the Rockaway Peninsula. Visible from the beach.
Yes.
I don't know all the pros and cons involved, but generally in favor of wind power.
Do you think Andrew Cuomo is doing enough to help Senate Democrats in New York?
Yes.
It's getting better at it.
Yes.
He endorsed my opponent, Senator Stavisky.
Did or do your children attend New York City public schools?
No.
I went to a public high school,
but
they don't have kids yet.
Don't have kids.
Yes, you can answer that. He said yes.
Have you ever voted for a member of the opposite party?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
I helped a member of the opposite party campaign, but I didn't vote for him.
Yeah.
Are you on Facebook?
I am. Oh, well, yes.
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 Barely, yes.
Should New York State legislators be required to disclose their sources of personal income? All of their sources of personal income?
Yes.
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 Eric. Great.
Whether currently holding office or seeking office, would you run for higher office besides what you're currently seeking?
What was the last part of the question?
Would you run, besides what you're running for now, would you run for higher office if elected?
I wouldn't rule it out. As John pointed out earlier, I ran for Congress last year. I ran for city controller. Right now, I'm only running for re-election, and I don't contemplate running for higher office. But you never say no in politics.
Greg, why don't you ask
him
that November
7th? Highly theoretical, but yes.
You know, I don't want to be misunderstood. I'm absolutely running to win. I'm trying my hardest to win. But I think Senator Stavisky had the original right idea. I mean, if I lose, I might just pack up and go be a school teacher. Go the opposite direction.
Aaron?
Okay, you can answer this with not a yes or no, but just free. Who is the best college basketball team?
St. John's, of course.
That's smart.
Go with St. John.
Unanimous. John, take it away.
Is running for office fun?
Can be.
Well, yes or no?
Overall, yes.
Yes, thrilling.
Yeah.
Parts of it are the best experiences I've ever had. Parts of it are the worst I've ever had.
Yes, yes, no, no.
I'm a lawyer, I'm sorry.
Not a yes, no, but best governor in New York State history.
New York State history?
Yes, no.
Mario Cuomo.
I'd agree with that.
Mr. Fuchs.
I'm not that well versed going back to all the governors, but I'd say Pataki.
I actually like both Cuomo and Pataki.
Yes. Alright, John, your last one. Go ahead.
Have you gambled at the Resorts World Casino at Aqueduct Racetrack?
Yes.
No.
No.
I hope to, and I haven't.
Aaron, last one for you.
Do you support term limits for the state assembly and state senate?
No.
Yes.
No.
How long would the term be if you support it?
I don't know.
Senator Stavisky had the best answer ever on that. She's not here, so I'll say it for her. She said there are term limits. People can just vote them out of office. But actually, I do support term limits.
All right, last one from Aaron, and then we'll do closing remarks.
Do you support state-mandated policies imposed on private sector businesses related to vacation, sick, and other benefits?
Yes.
I'd say no.
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Kim, we're going to give you 1 minute for closing remarks, and then we'll work our way down the line. Mr. Weprin, we'll give you up to 2 minutes. Go ahead.
First of all, I'll try to undo a little bit of the damage I did. You know, I'm a lawyer. I'm a first-time candidate. You know, as a lawyer, I'm very careful in terms of the cases I take. I don't take cases I don't know about. And you know, I will admit there are issues that were raised tonight that I was unfamiliar with. I apologize. I need to work harder and do my homework better. But what I do know about is, and actually what I didn't have an opportunity to say yet, and I'll try to say it very quickly, is that, you know, Flushing, you know, New York State did a study. Flushing has 30% higher growth than the rest of the city, and they have the highest job growth and the highest home ownership. So, and a lot of that is due to the Asian community. And I think that the way to at least try to solve our economic problems right now is to harness that power. I mean, what other solutions are there out there right now? You know, that's a real viable solution that people don't seem to get, even though I say this to them blue in the face. But my goal is to do that, to harness that power, to integrate economically the communities, and at least try to, you know, claw our way a little bit out of this this terrible recession.
For the last 50 years, we've been trying to figure out what to do with education. We can't figure it out. And the answer is that it's got to be let loose. It's got to go to the private sector. The American creativity and brilliance will figure out what to do with a system that is now broken. We're out of 35 countries, we're 14th in reading. 35 most industrialized countries, we're 14th, we rate 14th in reading, 17th in science, 25th in math. We recently achieved the lowest average SAT scores in 40 years. 65% of our students test at grade level, 65% of our students graduate high school. It can take up to $300,000 in 3 years to fire a bad teacher. And we spend $18,000 per pupil. And there are tuitions out there for $4,000, $7,000 for elementary and high school. And we have to go to a voucher system. Middle class families are being squeezed. They're paying for rich people to send their kids to public school. They're sending the and it would break open the educational field, and it would also give more people it would give people more money to spend in the economy.
Ms. Rozic.
So, like I said before, I'm deeply invested in this district and in this community and making government work for growing communities, for underrepresented communities, for young people, for women across the board. I really am eager to use my work ethic, my passion, and my know-how to get things done for Eastern Queens. And no matter which way you're voting in this election, you should go out and vote. You should pull that lever, fill in that bubble. Just go do it. Vote however you feel your conscience to vote, and make sure that you vote like your generation depended on it, because it's really, really crucial this year.
Yeah, I've been in elective office for 11 years, party office for 18 years. I served in the New York City Council for 8 years. I've served in the New York State Assembly the last 3 years. I hold holding public office to be a noble profession, an honor, something that I don't take for granted. Even though I may have been a little light about not having opposition, that was clearly not my choice. I would have been happy to compete in a competitive election, as I have in many, many elections. But I do take representing the public, representing my constituents very seriously. I'm actually very excited about the opportunity of representing a new district. It's actually 60% new from my current district. It starts in Eastern Queens, but goes significantly further west, including the entire St. John's area, Jamaica Hill area, Briarwood area, as well as going into Richmond Hill and South Ozone Park. It's a very diverse district. It probably has people from 200 different countries, over 30% Asian, heavily South Asian, about 20% Latino population, many, many diverse countries of origin. It's something that I plan on reaching out to over the next 2 years and spending a lot of time in outreach and making my office very accessible to the new immigrant community.
Thank you all. And before we adjourn, I just want to remind everybody here that we're going to be back 2 weeks from tonight for our federal candidate night. We've already confirmed Wendy Long, U.S. Senate candidate, Grace Meng, and Dan Halloran will be here, as well as Bob Halloran is going to be a surrogate for the Romney campaign, and the Obama campaign assures me that they're going to have a surrogate here as well. So we'll be back 2 weeks from tonight for our federal candidate night. And before we adjourn, I want to thank all the candidates for coming out. I want to thank the panelists for being here, and wish everybody a good night. Thank you.